Welcome to the meeting of the North Jersey Civil War Roundtable. Prior to our regular meeting, and I should call from now on, I think I'm going to start the meeting at this time, we have offered to libraries, historical societies, Civil War roundtables, the opportunity to speak to our group for a limited period of time. It really has to be a strict 8 or 9 minutes because we do start our program on time. One of the people who frequently watch our show is Barry Crompton. As a matter of fact, we have a members-only book group. He was invited to participate in that. Also on, I got to talk for other people who are coming on, it's the exact opposite, is Laurie, and he's from right now in Melbourne. So we have both ends of Australia covered. Barry, I want to welcome him, and please tell you who you are, what your group is, et cetera. You're on.
Thank you, Rich, and thank you, Henry, for the invitation. I really appreciate it. Just as a bit of a background, Australia was discovered by the English Captain Cook in 1770. And shortly after that, 1788, they had the first colonists who arrived from England. And as I said to one of the roundtables in America, the reason that they did that is the Georgia wouldn't take any more convicts during the War of Independence, so they decided to send out the convicts to Australia. 1901, we became a country, a commonwealth, but until that, each of the states had their own separate jurisdictions. The American Civil War, of course, was the biggest event in American history, and as a result of the 1849 gold rush in California, in the early 1850s, they found gold in Australia, in outside Melbourne and outside Sydney. As a result of that, our populations grew incredibly much. 1850s, Melbourne had the biggest population in the Southern Hemisphere. At the time of the Civil War, we had a visit by the Confederate ship Shenandoah, and it left Melbourne in January, February 1865 with an additional 42 crew members recruited in Australia, in Melbourne. Our Civil War roundtable began in 1972, so we've been going 51 years now. And the result of that was that we had had a reenactment group in Australia prior to that. We also had a visit by Ralph Newman and the NASA people in 1969, and they showed some of the Lincoln exhibits in the shopping centres around Australia. 1972, I was the founding secretary of our Civil War Roundtable, and we've gone through numbers over the years. There is an additional roundtable centred in Sydney and one in Brisbane, Queensland. We have been averaging 20 to 30 people per meeting on a monthly basis, 11 months every year. In the 1980s, we found out that there were Civil War veterans who came to Australia. So we've been extremely busy over the last 30 odd years, delving into the history of why the Civil War veterans came to Australia, why the visit of the Shenandoah came to Melbourne, why few Australians actually participated in the Civil War. There were people living in New York, Massachusetts, and also Pennsylvania who were Australian-born who served in Civil War regiments. 1977, I had my first trip to America, toured the battlefields for 13 weeks, met up with a lot of the roundtable people. I've returned to the US six times after that. And in 2015, the Civil War Roundtable of Australia was able to have an exhibition locally for the 150th anniversary of the Shenandoah's visit to Melbourne. We're very fortunate that we have had a very enthusiastic audience. We occasionally have had symposiums in Australia where we've been able to invite people to come from America to talk to us. Of course, it's very expensive to do that, but 2013 we had a visit from Ed Bars, which was absolutely wonderful because he was here during World War II after he'd been wounded. After that, of course, the COVID hit Australia, like everywhere else. And we decided about 2020 that we would begin to have Zoom meetings. So now that we have the ability to meet with our American friends or so, it is a delight to be able to talk internationally. Most of our members are Australian born. We have a couple from England born and a couple from America, the result of Australian war brides who went over to America after World War II and then returned with their families. My own family came from Manchester, England in 1863 as a result of the cotton famine. No longer any work in Manchester, England or so, and they came to Australia. So although I didn't realise it, I was able to link my own interest in the Civil War. I have a large library due to the fact that we, back in the 1980s, when we were doing our work on the research for veterans in Australia, we had to have our own books, of course, and travelling over to America, I've also been able to pick up quite a few volumes from the bookshops. Until 2007, we had the availability of surface mail postage to Australia. So it was reasonably easy to buy books and get them shipped over to Australia. However, after 2007, it became extremely expensive to ship them airmail. And now a lot of the books that I buy are outside of Amazon and other locations where I can get them electronically. So we have a meeting every month other than in December. We've got our Christmas party turning up shortly, and I look forward to further and more information from our links with the Civil War and particularly with the North Jersey Civil War Roundtable. Thank you.
Thank you. By the way, you had Ed Bars was one of the classic people in the, and we had him. Ed Bars, I think, he made it a point to see other roundtables. A great writer, great scriber of battles. And at our annual dinner a number of years ago, he was our speaker. That was at the Basking Ridge Country Club that we had him. It was a great honor for us to have him. Actually, he had spoken before a group once before, but this was the dinner. This was the dinner itself. So you really got a prize. You really have a prize with Ed Boris as your speaker.
Fascinating man. Fortunately, I was able to attend some of the Civil War Roundtable congresses organized by Jerry Russell of Civil War Roundtable Associates. And I went to Vicksburg, and of course, Ed was there tramping over the battlefields, rain, hail, and snow, but Ed was there. And of course, he was a mainstay, and we really look up to the people like Ed.
Yeah, he got interested in the battle that was at New Providence, his arm was shot, wounded, and through that. I can't think of it was New something. I can't think of where it was, but that's where his injury came from. Good evening, John Harper is on. John, we've been speaking to got two members, or to everybody else, I'll tell you. We have two people, Lori from he's speaking from Perth, Australia.
Yes.
Barry Compton is the one that he attended our book group.
Yes, so he did.
So we now have two people from Australia.
Wonderful.
Yeah, that's a great program. So he's just describing obviously interest, you know, why Australia with a roundtable there. A very interesting talk. Barry, I got him to put you on the spot one more time. Ready?
Yes,
Counsel, would you accept an honorable, what do they call it? An honorable membership on our group and become an honorary member?
I would be absolutely delighted to. And if I ever get back to America, the first place I'll go to is New Jersey.
That's wonderful. Sure. You want to know someone will take you up on it? Well, why not? I think it's great. No, seriously. In any event, so we now want to have a member from Australia. I'm really proud that you're part of us.
Thank you, Henry. Thank you, Rich.
Thank you. Okay, now we'll go back on to the members itself. I'd like to introduce as many as possible before the names start popping in. I got to tell you something right now. We're at 52 people. Last night, I attended a lecture from Constitution Center in Philadelphia, which is also a nationwide group. And they were discussing Madison and the Constitution. We have more people right now than they had on Constitution Center. And you talk about a phenomenal facility in Philadelphia. And I was really surprised. We've now crossed the line. We're now ahead of them right now, which is, to me, that's, you know, it's exciting to see what's happening through here. We will start on time. I'm going to give a brief I always say we start at 6:55. And the only reason, Barry, that's the other thing. When we say it's 6:55, because if you write 7 o'clock, people say, where was it? Was it 7:30 or was that a quarter to 8? So I put 6:55 and I figure everybody will look at 6:55 and say, why? And at that moment in time, they know that we start at that time. That sole reason has nothing to do with, somebody gave me an existential reason why 6:55 was important in numerology or something. Nah, it was 6:50. Sometimes I start at 6:57. So people keep on toes. And then he asked, why did you start at 6:57 as opposed to 6:55? So as long as I got you thinking, then you remember the time and then you remember to come on time. And that's basically all it is. So let me just tell you who we are, as long as we have, let's say, 54 people. But I'll give you the introduction so we could semi-start on time. People are coming on. Nah, give me another one. What time is it now? Yeah, good enough. I got 6:58. That's okay. I don't do long introductions. And I said to people before, we do not do, God forbid, minute reports or treasury report of anything else. But we are the North Jersey Civil War Roundtable. We're located right now in Morris County, New Jersey. People are interested in the American Revolution. It was Washington's headquarters on two separate occasions. Washington spent more time in Morris County than any other time, any other place in the American Revolution. And that's where we are, 5 miles away from it. Our roundtables have been in existence for over 20 years. We have already had two Pulitzer Prize winners. There was James McPherson, Battle Cry of Freedom. He spoke several times before our group. And in addition, he was honored at our dinner. We had Eric Foner, Pulitzer Prize winner, who won it for Reconstruction. And he spoke before our group a number of years ago. We would have had a third Pulitzer Prize winner, Edward Larson. He unfortunately, because of COVID, that program was canceled. We've had pretty much the significant authors as part of our group, or even honored at our group. We had, should have had a list prepared for you guys, but Scott, when they send you the welcome, you'll see some of the people we had. We had Ed Bars, of course, noted Michael Burlingame, noted Lincoln scholar with several volumes on his deck. We've had James Bud Robertson, who's a definitive author for Stonewall Jackson. I'm just trying to think of some of the names off the top of my head. S.J. Wynn, who wrote Rebel Yell. We had him a few years ago. So those are some of the speakers we've had over the years. Louis Mazur, who's probably one of the greatest lecturers you'll ever hear. He won two of our book awards through that. We are the only Civil War roundtable, and you'll hear it tonight, of an annual Civil War presentation. Other groups may have a discussion about legal problems. We've had an annual program, which is featured and started by John Harper, who's on Judge Harper. And all the presenters are attorneys. All the presenters have credentials. And when I talk about tonight's program, before I really get interested, so I'm probably winging it as I'm going along, we also have a members-only book group. And I was discussing it before. Our book group is not the book of the month. We pick a book and Judge Harper prepares a series of questions for us and we discuss them at length. If we don't complete the questions, we continue on with the discussion. It's the journey is the important part, not the destination. And that becomes the level. We also invite other members. This is the only thing that's a members only group. the book group. We also invite other members to listen to the group to audit it. And, periodically we get a nice group of people, and I have to tell them, nobody will pick on you. And they listen to, you know, so what that becomes, it's a learning experience. That's where we're there. A number of years ago, we had, it was at the Frelinghuysen Arboretum, there was called Medicinal Plants of the Civil War.
Hello.
Yeah, and what happened at the time, they had plants that were used, and we funded, that was one of the things that we funded. We also have, and we're going to probably go back to this year, we also have a book award, and pretty much nationwide, I don't know, I was really surprised to the extent of it when my wife picks up, looks at caller ID, and she says, Simon and Schuster is calling you? And I have to go, yeah, sure. Don't they always, you know, but that's the group that we have, which is exciting through that. Okay, tonight's presentation, and I'll let, tonight's presentation are two of our attorneys, John Maloney and Tom Hilder. Before, I'll let them, John, give the their credentials, but I must say to you, this is program one of importance. In New Jersey, and I imagine in quite a number of states, attorneys are required to take continuing legal education courses every year. That's a part of the requirement. Last year, apparently somebody from continuing legal education watched the program and offered the presenters the opportunity to give that program before continuing legal education. The lawyers who took out, they wasn't watching our program because they wouldn't get credit. So they had to take it as CLA credit. And John Jay sent me, I wanted to watch it on for continuing legal education. The lawyers paid $200. They got credit, but they paid $200. That's the caliber of the program that you're going to watch tonight. John Maloney, I leave it to you, and that starts our meeting.
Rich, just let me interrupt here. I would ask the attendees to turn off their video so as not to distract the speakers tonight, and also mute their audio. So with that, John, I'll turn it over to you. And I'll
wait. Can you get this onto strictly on speaker? You know, so will the little boxes disappear? Do it from your end.
I would ask everybody to turn off their audio. I can do it. It just takes me a little bit more time. John, I'm going to bring up the presentation now.
Okay.
I can get there.
Great. Excellent. Hey, thank you very much, and welcome to the annual legal presentation of the North Jersey Civil War Roundtable. My name is Jay Maloney. I'm a trial lawyer with the law firm of Traflet and Fabian in Morristown, New Jersey. My focus is on commercial litigation and pharmaceutical litigation. And with me this evening is Tom Hilder, who I think was smart enough to retire, but he was with the Mandelbaum law firm and did also focus on commercial litigation. And we've done this program for a number of years together. This program is going to be a change of pace for many members of the roundtable. For the last several months, we've spent examining military campaigns and particular generals. And tonight, we're going to shift to the war of competing ideas and legal principles. They also were fought, but they were fought out in courts and legislatures during and after the Civil War. Tonight, the specific issue is secession and whether and how that constitutional issue was resolved by the Civil War. Now, the U.S. Constitution is silent on the issue of secession, and it remains silent even after the passage of the so-called Civil War amendments, that's the 13th through 15th Amendment, which were intended to reflect the changes in the structure of the national government as a result of the Civil War. Now, by secession, I'm referring to the decision by the 11 states of the South to leave the Union in 1860 and 1861 and form the Confederate States of America. Secession obviously ignores the Federal Supremacy Clause in the Constitution, and it also refuses to accept the basic principle of democracy that the majority vote prevails. Now, secession is a separate and distinct constitutional issue from the issue of slavery with which it is most often associated. And as Tom will recount, the issue of secession has come up in other contexts in American history during the antebellum period, in particular with the blockade in the connection with the Hartford Convention during the War of 1812. It also showed up in the form of state nullification in the tariff crisis with South Carolina. But the point here is that the secession issue must be looked at separately from the legal support for the institution of slavery. Now, the traditional view has been that the issue of secession was decided by the Union military victory in the Civil War. This is often referred to by the term the battlefield verdict. James McPherson, probably one of the deans of the Civil War historians, has written in his book, Battle Hymn of the Republic, quote, "Certain large consequences of the war seem clear. Secession and slavery were killed, never to be revived during the century and a quarter since Appomattox." Well, the evidence suggests that the military victory resolved only the political issue of secession. The constitutional issue of secession continued in dispute in the post-Civil War period. Now, this evening, Tom is going to talk about the concept and sort of historiography of secession during the antebellum period. I will return and discuss secession during the Civil War itself and the concept of secession in the period after the Civil War. So let me start now and turn it over to you, Tom, to talk about secession and the antebellum period.
Okay. Thanks, Jay. And I apologize, everybody. I'm undergoing some major eye problems at the moment, so I may stumble a little bit when I try to look at my notes. But in any event, in our discussion of the constitutional issue of secession prior to the Civil War, we will consider our separation from England, the relationship of the states and the Union, the pre-Civil War disputes over the Union, the pre-Civil War disputes over the state and federal sovereignty, the disputed constitutional authority of the federal courts over state courts, the nullification crisis, as Jay mentioned, in the 1830s, and the debate over secession. The preamble of the Constitution begins with these words, "We, the people of the United States." A key issue which will arise in the antebellum period is how do we characterize people in that sentence? Is it the people of 50 states tied together in one union? Or is it one American people divided among 50 states? The answer requires that we examine the conception of state sovereignty embraced by the South. It is upon that conception that the South's claim of a right of secession, is based. When we refer to sovereignty in our discussion, we are referring to the ultimate locus or place of political authority, that is, governmental power. Let's turn first to the Declaration of Independence. The Declaration, which declares the American colonies to be free and independent states. However, no colony declared independence before being authorized to do so by the Continental Congress, which functioned as an informal government. And no state government gave itself a constitution before being invited to do so by that Congress. After the colonies gained independence, they joined together in a confederation and perpetual union under the Articles of Confederation in 1781. Several provisions are noteworthy for our discussion. The articles state that the union is perpetual. Each state retained its sovereignty, freedom, and independence in every power, jurisdiction, and right not expressly delegated by the Confederation to the United States in Congress assembled. In form, the Confederation was more like a present-day interstate compact than a constitution. James Madison, called the founder of our constitution, called it a league of sovereign powers and not a political constitution by which states became one sovereign power. He lamented that its concept of sovereignty would imply a power of an individual state to dissolve the union altogether if it concluded its rights were violated. The conventional modern view of state and federal sovereignty is that under the Articles of Confederation, the states retain most of their sovereignty, like independent nations bound together only by treaties. The new Constitution rejected the notion that the nation was a collection of states and instead created a direct link between the national government and the people of the United States. The federal government's legitimacy was said to owe its existence to the act of the whole people who created it. As we will see, this was the view of Abraham Lincoln. Now let's address the Constitution. The Constitution clearly established more than a league. George Washington spoke of it as consolidating the Union and perfecting the general government of the Union. Indeed, the preamble states specifically, "We, the people of the United States, in order to form a more perfect union." Those words will play an important role in the secession debates. In McCulloch versus Maryland, decided in 1819, Chief Justice John Marshall described the government of the Union as emphatically and truly a government of the people in rebutting the argument that the Constitution was a compact between state governments. An examination of the Constitution clearly shows its central purpose was to strengthen the weak government created by the Articles of Confederation. Indeed, the Constitution contains a formidable list of national powers. Its stated goal of promoting the general welfare required the federal government to have that formidable array of powers. We see that the Constitution gave the federal government the core powers normally associated with a sovereign nation. Powers such as the power to make war, raise its own armies, enter treaties, tax its citizens, regulate internal and foreign trade, and decide legal issues. If sovereignty is a matter of power, the Constitution seems to transfer a great deal of power to a national government. That the Constitution was meant to give, and on its face does give, sweeping powers to the federal government is supported both by the Federalist Papers and the early decisions of the Supreme Court. Although states' rights activists relied on the 10th Amendment's reservation of powers not delegated to the United States nor prohibited to it by the Constitution to the states or the people, the amendment muddies the waters somewhat. Who are the people? All Americans collectively, or all Americans as members of state populations? When confronted by what they deem as an abuse of federal powers, states' rights advocates turn to nullification and resistance to federal coercion in their attempt to revive state sovereignty. They relied on their contention that the Constitution was a compact among sovereign states in their attempts to block what they considered were abuses of federal power in order to maintain their state sovereignty as they saw it. As we will discuss later, John C. Calhoun relied on the compact theory in his attempts to protect slavery from national interference. Of course, Calhoun was senator from South Carolina, and previous to that was the vice president of the United States. So we continue our historical journey. Next of note is the Alien and Sedition Acts, which were passed in 1798. The creation of two political party types arising out of the disagreement between Thomas Jefferson and Alexander Hamilton over the extent of federal power, and in particular, the new government's financial policies, and specifically the constitutionality of the Bank of the United States, led to the passage of the notorious Alien and Sedition Acts in 1798. The Alien Act allowed the President John Adams to expel any non-citizen he considered dangerous to the peace and safety of the United States without any hearing or explanation. The Sedition Act was an attempt to suppress criticism of the government. It made it a crime to print any false, scandalous, and malicious writings against the government of the United States or either House of Congress with intent to defame or bring them into contempt or disrepute. Having left the struggle in Congress and with no prospect of, having lost the struggle in Congress and with no prospect of help from the Federalist-dominated courts, Thomas Jefferson drafted in response to the acts what became the Kentucky Resolutions. They called upon the states to join in declaring the acts, alien sedition, void and of no force, and to take steps to ensure that neither act nor any other of the general government's not plainly and intentionally authorized by the Constitution would be exercised within their respective territories. Jefferson's involvement was kept secret, and his draft was edited so as to better suit public opinion in Kentucky. When the original draft was published in 1832, it was seized upon by John C. Calhoun because it stated that every state has a natural right to nullify and then on their own authority, all assumptions of power by others within their limits and to take measures of its own to ensure that unconstitutional federal authority was not exercised within their respective territories. Jefferson's closing statement in that draft, which was revealed for the first time in 1832, was that nullification is the rightful remedy. In the end, however, the actual remedy in the public version that was released simply asked the other states to concur in declaring these acts void and of no force and to request their repeal. Also occurring at this time was something called the Virginia Resolutions. The Virginia Resolutions were drafted by James Madison. The original draft called upon other states to cooperate in the annulment of the Alien and Sedition Acts. Madison, however, was more cautious than Jefferson about giving a state legislature any power to block federal legislation. The Virginia Resolutions also spoke of the Constitution as a compact to which the states are parties. However, they spoke of the states as collectivity, and the states had the right and were duty bound to interpose for arresting the progress of this perceived evil and for maintaining within their respective limits the authorities, rights, and liberties appertaining to them. Those are the words of the Virginia Resolutions. What that meant, as you might gather, was unclear. The resolutions merely requested other states to concur in declaring the acts unconstitutional and to take necessary and proper measures for cooperating with Virginia in maintaining unimpaired the authorities, rights, and liberties reserved to the states respectively or to the people. The resolutions, however, according to Madison, did not imply a legislative power to annul the judgment of the courts. They were merely statements of opinion unaccompanied with any other effect. The Virginia and Kentucky resolutions were not well received, however. Other states either ignored them or savaged them. However, they were later cited in support of their contentions by the secessionists. Next, we turn to something called the Hartford Convention. This was a series of meetings from December 15, 1814 to January 1815 in Hartford, Connecticut, in which New England leaders of the Federalist Party met to discuss their grievances concerning the ongoing War of 1812 and the political problems arising from the federal government's increasing power. The convention discussed a number of proposed constitutional reforms and their grievances with the Louisiana Purchase and the embargo of 1807. However, weeks after the convention ended, news of Andrew Jackson's overwhelming victory in New Orleans swept over the Northeast, discrediting and disgracing the Federalists, limiting them as a major party. The conventions were controversial at the time, and many historians consider it a contributing factor to the downfall of the Federalist Party. There are many reasons for this, not the least of which was the suggestion that the states of New England, the Federalist main base, secede from the Union and create a new country. Although many historians doubt the New England Federalists were seriously considering secession, later on, Southern secessionists cited the convention as a precedent in the crisis that preceded the Civil War. Let's turn a moment to the judiciary during this period. While Jefferson and Madison assigned some role to the states in interpreting the Constitution, the federal courts increasingly emphasized during this time national supremacy. With key decisions handed down by the Marshall Court between 1815 and 1828. The Marshall Court found itself embroiled in a series of disputes about whether state courts had independent authority to interpret the Constitution. Madison and Calhoun saw a tight connection between these issues and the more drastic questions of secession and nullification. The Supreme Court's jurisdiction over state courts was affirmed. Taken together, these decisions undermine any effort to use state sovereignty as a shield against perceived abuses by the federal government. On constitutional issues, the state courts were subordinated to the Supreme Court. These decisions reflected Chief Justice Marshall's vision of the federal judiciary's role in the constitutional scheme. Marshall challenged the compact theory and proclaimed the existence of a collective American people. In his opinion, the Constitution was not a compact, but the act of a single party, that party being the people of the United States, assembled in their respective states and adopting a government for the whole nation. He concluded, all arguments founded on leagues and compacts must be fallacious when those arguments apply to a government like that of the United States. In 1828, South Carolina issued a formal protest against a recently enacted tariff, arguing that the protective tariff was unfair and unconstitutional. This brought us to what's been referred to as the nullification crisis. In December 1831, President Andrew Jackson called for tariff reform, but the tariff of 1832 did not contain major reductions that South Carolina wanted. A specific session of the South Carolina legislature called for a convention, and that convention issued a nullification proclamation. In 1831, Calhoun gave a major address defending nullification, arguing that the Constitution is a compact between the states. Relying on Madison's Virginia resolutions, he proclaimed the right of each state in the last resort to interpose itself against the abuse of federal power, preserving what he called the sacred distribution of the federal and state power as originally settled. The ordinance declared the tariff statutes utterly null and void in South Carolina and directed the legislature to pass statutes preventing their implementation in their state. It prohibited appeals to the United States Supreme Court relating to the ordinance. And if the federal government responded forcibly, secession would result. In response, President Jackson issued a presidential proclamation arguing that nullification was unacceptable because there was no check on its abuse. The threat of secession was illegal, each state having expressly parted with many powers so as to constitute jointly with the other states a single nation, and which did not possess any right to secede, because secession does not break a league. It, in fact, destroys the unity of a nation. Jackson believed he had no choice but to intervene because Article 2 of the Constitution directed him to take care that the laws be faithfully executed. In a letter, he stated that when a faction in the state attempting to nullify a constitutional law of Congress or to destroy the Union, the balance of people composing the Union have a perfect right to coerce them to obedience. A compromise in Congress was reached on the tariff issue and the crisis passed. Now, James Madison opposed the claim of nullification power. In his view, the national power was secured by the Supremacy Clause, Article 6, Clause 2, and the extension of the judicial power to all cases arising under federal law. Within the constitutional scheme, the federal judicial power must be paramount, said Madison. Madison denied those supporting nullification could rely on his Virginia resolution. The debates on the resolution, he said, do not reference a constitutional right of an individual state to arrest by force the operation of a law of the United States. It instead called for a concurrent action by all the states to secure a change in federal laws, obviously a much less drastic remedy. We've now worked our way up to the time and issue of secession. The question of secession brought the feverish debates over states' rights to a boil. In many respects, these debates were replays of the debates over interposition, blocking of federal law, and nullification. Several different kinds of arguments were made for secession. One, it was claimed to be a valid state prerogative under the Constitution itself, even though the Constitution, as Jay mentioned, does not provide the states with a right of secession. Indeed, it is silent on the subject. The claim was based on the compact argument that John C. Calhoun and others advanced, namely that the Union was a revocable compact, a revocable agreement. The federal union was the creature of the states, said the secessionists, and existed only because it was useful for carrying out what the states could not accomplish individually. Since the states, or more accurately, the people within the states, retained the ultimate authority in the United States, they could withdraw from the union if and when the federal government transgressed the limits of its powers as granted in the Constitution. Alternatively, they could simply withdraw from the union when they believed the union no longer served their needs. Advocates of secession defended it as an extra outside constitutional act as well, like the Declaration of Independence. Secession in their eyes could be viewed as a justified act of revolution or an inherent right of self-determination. The election of Abraham Lincoln in November of 1860 ignited the secession crisis. In the South's view, the era of compromise embodied in such measures as the Missouri Compromise of 1820, the Compromise of 1850, which included a new Fugitive Slave Act, the Kansas-Nebraska Act of 1854, and the aborted Lecompton Constitution, that time was over. After the election of 1860, secessionists warned that the Republicans would soon control both houses of Congress, as well as the presidency, and would ban slavery wherever the federal government had jurisdiction, and would continue admitting free states until they had enough of a majority to amend the Constitution and abolish slavery nationally. Even continuing limiting slavery, as these compromises that we mentioned briefly had done, even limiting it geographically, would be an economic disaster in their view. There were fears of a race war. Secessionists also recalled other grievances, such as the tariff secession. And all of this promised a new era of prosperity if secession occurred. In other words, secession was going to be, whatever its constitutional and arguments in support of it may be, an economic boon. Between Lincoln's election in November 1860 and his inauguration on March 4th, 1861, seven states, beginning with South Carolina on December 20, 1860, seceded, and four more followed between April 17 and May 20, 1860, following the attack on Fort Sumter, which began on April 12, 1861. Henry, you could just for a moment flash the map, if you would, of the seceded states. I think people know them, but you get a sense of them where you see the states that succeeded, the border states, whatever. The lower area shows the states that seceded before Fort Sumter. Then there are four states in yellow there that seceded after the attack on Fort Sumter. So at this time, the president was not Abraham Lincoln. He had been elected. It was James Buchanan. And his response was hesitating. His attorney general advised that Buchanan had little power to block secession, although he could defend and even retake federal property. At this point, Fort Sumter had not occurred. But this was the limits of Buchanan's constitutional power. He could do little about secession beyond denouncing it. On December 3, 1860, in his statement on secession, Buchanan blamed the North for the crisis. He asserted there had been an incessant and violent agitation of the slavery question throughout the North for the previous quarter century. However, secession, in Buchanan's view, was the wrong remedy. It was unlawful. The South's grievances should be met otherwise, namely with a constitutional amendments providing greater security for slavery. He also believed the Constitution did not empower the federal government to make war against the state. Buchanan's speech has been called a confession of national impotence and the last major act of the federal government truly serving the slaveholders' interest. In its declaration of the causes of secession, South Carolina argued the northern states had breached their constitutional obligations by denouncing slavery as sinful, permitting open establishment of anti-slavery societies, and encouraging and arresting fugitive slaves and by inciting slave insurrections. This was their claim. The declaration claimed the Republican Party's program was to exclude South Carolina from the common territory, make over the Supreme Court, and ultimately eliminate slavery. Now let's go to the views of the major proponents in this constitutional argument. We already mentioned John C. Calhoun, but what I'm referring to now are the views of Jefferson Davis and Abraham Lincoln. Jefferson Davis, of course, formerly being a senator, but being the president of the Confederacy, and Abraham Lincoln, of course, the president as of March 18, 1864. Let's start with Jefferson Davis. He recognized the Constitution does not specifically address secession, but he relied on the compact theory of the Constitution, as we discussed John C. Calhoun did. He had little to say about the text of the Constitution. He was not a textualist. In his opinion, the fact that the Constitution became effective only because the states that ratified it showed its true character as a compact between independent states. He contended there was an absolute right of local self-government or state sovereignty, which was the primal and leading idea throughout the formation of the Union. His concept of the historical formation of the Union, obviously widely disparate from that of the Northernists, the Unionists, and Abraham Lincoln, as we'll discuss. The Union, as far as Davis was concerned, was an artificial or conventional nation created for certain limited purpose, such as foreign relations. Paramount authority still resided with the states. He further maintained that secession was the inherent right of nations to disregard the obligation of compacts of all sorts by declaring themselves no longer bound by them in any way. The North, in his view, had materially breached the compact, basically a breach of compact, by failing to comply with the obligation to return fugitive slaves. Abraham Lincoln's view can be found most fully in his first inaugural address. Perpetuity is implied, if not expressed, he said, in the fundamental law of all nations. The Constitution is such a law. The history of the Union, he said, confirms its perpetuity. It was formed in 1774 by the Articles of Confederation, by the Articles of Association, which was a loose association. That was in 1774. And by the then matured further and continued by the Declaration of Independence, and further matured by the Articles of Confederation, which the states agreed should be perpetual. The Constitution was ordained to form a more perfect union, as stated in the preamble, more perfect than the union that existed up to its adoption. He argued if the union could be destroyed by one or more states, the union is less perfect, not more perfect, but less perfect than before the Constitution, having lost the vital element of perpetuity. Lincoln admitted, however, that if a majority deprived a minority of any clearly written constitutional right, it might, in a moral point of view, justify revolution, certainly if it was a vital right. However, he said, no such claim could be made by the South. At most, there was a reasonable difference in opinion about constitutional issues. If minorities seceded over every dispute about the meaning of the Constitution, democracy would be impossible. Plainly, he said, the central idea of secession is the essence of anarchy. The only true sovereign of a free people is a majority held in constraint by constitutional checks and limitations. and always changing easily with deliberate changes of popular opinion and sentiments. Lincoln hoped, obviously, that things could be worked out, that some kind of amendments could be reached, that some kind of agreements could be reached. But at this point, there was no turning back. Now, I want to take a moment to talk about the Declaration of Independence, which the South often sought to connect to secession through the American Revolution. In other words, a parallel between the American Revolution and secession. South Carolina's Declaration of the Causes of Secession recounted the origins of the American Revolution, beginning with the Declaration of Independence's proclamation that the colonies are and of right ought to be free and independent states. The South Carolina Declaration itself ends with a similar proclamation that South Carolina was a separate and independent state with all the powers attending that status. Similarly, in his inaugural address, Davis said that the South had, quote, merely asserted the rights which the Declaration of Independence defined to be inalienable. Southerners who were skeptical of the constitutionality of secession bought into this argument and frequently invoked the right of revolution as found in the Declaration of Independence instead. Now, in invoking the Declaration, Southerners were appealing to a shared assumption of Americans on both sides. In his first inaugural, Lincoln explicitly reaffirmed the right to revolution proclaimed by the Declaration, as I previously mentioned. Lincoln rejected, however, that the Southern states had been denied any written, vital constitutional right that would justify revolution. In his first inaugural, he said that if the people who inhabit the United States ever grow weary of the existing government, they can exercise their constitutional right of amending it. Or, he said, their revolutionary right to dismember or overthrow it. Those words, of course, were seized upon by some secessionists. However, in Lincoln's view, and why that was not applicable, is that the Southern states were not seeking to overthrow the United States. They were seeking only to separate from it, that is, secede. This raised the question of whether, since they had ratified the Constitution, they had a constitutional right to do so, or whether the Union had a constitutional right to prevent them from doing so. Let us consider briefly whether the Southern grievances might be that would justify a right to revolution. Well, the tariff issue, which was one in the 1830s, that had been resolved basically. The remaining justifications related to the abhorrent institution of slavery. Alexander Stevens, the vice president of the Confederacy, explained that the original framers had erroneously believed in human equality. Secessionists found racial equality would result from Republican control of government, or they feared that there would be the risk of a race war and ultimately a racial amalgamation would occur. One must then ask, in considering secession in light of the Declaration of Independence, what were the rights and liberties for which Confederates contended? A, a right to own slaves. B, a right to take human property into the territories. C, freedom from the coercive powers of a central government. In other words, a right of a property in human beings. The slaveholders were claiming an inalienable right in their view, their asserted right to hold the black man in a degraded, servile position, unchanging for perhaps the next 100 years, as it had remained unchanged essentially for the previous 200 years. Secession could not be justified as an effort to shake off, as the American colonies did, an oppressive government. As of 1860, indeed, the federal government had not done anything to harm the South, No right to own another human being is an inalienable right to which men are endowed by the Creator. The words of the Declaration of Independence. So in conclusion, in coercing the South, the North cannot be accused of violating any moral right to revolution. This was Lincoln's position, and one I suggest history has validated. Now, with the Civil War raging in the background, we move on to Jay's discussion of the constitutional issues related to secession during and after the Civil War. Thank you.
Thanks, Tom. I think the takeaway from the interpretation of secession during the Civil War is not much guidance, but it did have implications for the conduct of the war. And here we're going to look at three different sources. One is Lincoln, the other is the Supreme Court, and the third is the Confederate States of America themselves. First, as to Lincoln, Tom has already told us that Lincoln believed that the states had no constitutional authority to secede. And in this, he agreed with President Buchanan. Buchanan, however, did not think he had the power to coerce the states to remain in the Union. Lincoln, like Andrew Jackson before him, seriously disagreed. Lincoln believed he had the authority and indeed the duty to coerce the states back into the Union. When he saw what was happening, he described it as a rebellion and an insurrection, both of which terms are in the Constitution, and the Constitution clearly gives the president the power to quell rebellions and put down insurrections. You'll notice that Lincoln, in all of his discussions, never says that the Confederacy or the Confederate States of America is a legitimate government or a separate nation. For him, the challenge was, how do you maintain the republic, the perpetual republic, in the face of an armed rebellion? Now, these had implications for the way Lincoln conducted the war. First, there were several theorists who said, in the face of secession, let them go in peace. That wasn't Lincoln's view, and he didn't give anybody any time to consider alternatives. What do I mean by that? The day after Sumter was fired on, Lincoln diametrically changed his view on the powers of the president. He called up 75,000 troops to be given by the various states. He imposed the blockade. He said that these troops were going to be trained and they were going to enforce the federal law. The immediate impact of calling up those troops was that the four states in the Upper South left the Union and joined the Confederacy. So Lincoln's decision, prompted the war. At the same time of this proclamation, Lincoln put off until July 4th, clearly two and a half more months, any review by Congress of his unilateral actions. Not until July 4th, 1861, did Lincoln go before Congress and in effect say, this is what I've done out of necessity, calling up the troops, indeed asking for 400,000 more, imposed the blockade, suspend habeas corpus. He said practical necessity dictated these actions. And further, he asked Congress to ratify his conduct. The issue of secession and its constitutionality just was not addressed. Let's go to the Supreme Court. As a result of the blockade that Lincoln established on the southern ports, three Confederate ships were seized and their contents taken as prizes, and there was a challenge that reached the Supreme Court. The Supreme Court, in a very close decision, 5-4, decided a couple of things. One, it was not going to take a position as to the legitimacy or the constitutionality of secession. However, it was going to create what has come to be known as dual sovereignty, in that the court said, you know, a blockade, which is really a matter of international law, can be applied in these circumstances out of necessity, and the president was authorized to blockade the ports. And they further said that the president had this power, even though Congress had not approved it. But the Supreme Court ducked the issue of secession. Well, what about the Confederate Constitution itself? We've had discussions in earlier roundtable presentations about the Confederate Constitution. And we all know it was modeled in large part, copied from the text of the US Constitution as it existed in 1860, including federal courts, Article 3, even though a Supreme Court of the Confederacy was never established. Indeed, the Confederate Constitution tracked most of the US Constitution, with the exception of slavery. Obviously, they made slavery legal. They made for enforcement of the fugitive slave law. And they said that slavery would be allowed in any territory still to be acquired. But on the quintessential issue of secession, was it permitted or was it prohibited? The Confederate Constitution is entirely silent. Of course, they had a supremacy clause because they, in effect, copied the entire Constitution, but it never became an issue in any decision. Again, silence on the issue of secession. So we next have to turn to what happens after Appomattox to the discussion of the issue of secession.
Just listening to a Zoom meeting.
If we have somebody on the line, if they would kindly mute themselves, I'd appreciate it.
The Civil War.
The first thing we should discuss.
Legal talk.
Okay.
Please mute yourself.
Following Appomattox, there indeed was an effort on the part of Congress to propose a constitutional amendment that would have, in effect, declared the permanency of the Union. Now, it did not succeed. It did not gather support for one reason. That reason being that those in Congress said, if we amend the Constitution to make this point, we are essentially admitting that there's an ambiguity in the Constitution on the point of secession. Moreover, it would be a very difficult amendment to write, since most amendments deal prospectively, henceforward, and not, in effect, say, for all those who are interested, the Union has always been permanent and secession was never allowed. That difficulty having been raised, it shows that Congress was thinking about the problem. But as happened in the early days of the Republic, where in effect the Federalists said, we don't need a separate Bill of Rights because that's already implied in the text of the Constitution itself. And the Anti-Federalists said, no, you don't. You have to have a Bill of Rights or we're not going to ratify the Constitution. That argument finally, as a matter of practical necessity, came down to a compromise where the Federalists said, okay, our first act of business in the new Congress is going to be to enact a separate Bill of Rights to satisfy those advocates. The same kind of thinking and resolution did not happen in the Congress following the Civil War. Secondly, the Reconstruction policy that was being implemented by the radical Republicans was based on a notion, not that secession was constitutional, but that secession was effective. What they wanted to say is that we should treat the Southern states as conquered provinces, and therefore we're not going to be concerned about the niceties of limits of federal power. In fact, ousting existing state governments and inserting military governments because of constitutional concerns. However, notwithstanding the premise of Reconstruction policies that secession created this separate nation, which was now going to be reconstructed by the Congress, they did not want to address the issue of secession. The next topic involves the controversial trials, anticipated trials of Jefferson Davis and Robert E. Lee for treason. Now, you might say, well, treason is an entirely different subject than secession, and you would be right. But here is how the issue arises. Treason is defined in the Constitution itself as levying war against the United States, or adhering to or giving aid and comfort to the enemies of the United States. Clearly, this was Jefferson Davis's job. Every day he got up, and his job was to levy war against the United States. The same might be said of General Lee. So it appears that there would be a prima facie case of treason that could be made out against both Davis and Lee. However, there is an affirmative defense that both Lee and Davis had. And that defense is one based on secession, meaning treason is a loyalty crime. And both Davis and Lee would be saying, it wasn't me who was acting. I was no longer a citizen of the United States. I was following my state, which had already seceded. And therefore, I could not commit treason against the United States. Now, interesting argument. What was the implication of this? Well, the implication of their defense is the following, and we'll take them separately, Davis first and then Lee. The US government was afraid to try Davis for fear that they would lose. And if they lost, it would somehow undermine the battlefield verdict, as well as make them look pretty damn stupid. Now, obviously, at the beginning, when Jefferson Davis was captured in May of 1865, there were cries of vengeance, hang Jefferson Davis from the nearest apple tree. But it took them more than 3 years to get any kind of trial underway. And during that time, a couple of things were happening. Jefferson Davis, of course, was a martyr. And he wanted to be a martyr, and he wasn't interested in looking for any pardon. He thought he was right, and he thought that the court would find him right. Step number two, the government had legitimate concerns about how the trial would turn out. Why? Because they made some procedural decisions that made their task more difficult. What were they? Well, number one, the US government and the Attorney General Speed decided, you know, we cannot try Jefferson Davis by a military commission, which, you know, by the way, gives us some power over who is making the decision, a group of generals. Speed felt, you know, we had some rightful criticism of the way the Lincoln conspirators were tried by a military commission. We do not want that kind of criticism with respect to Jefferson Davis, who had become a symbol of the Confederacy. And therefore, they decided Davis must be tried in a federal court. Well, secondly, they decided he had to be tried in a before a jury in the jurisdiction where the crime was committed, namely Richmond, Virginia. So all of a sudden, the government is facing a federal jury trial in Richmond, where there was always concern, notwithstanding what efforts they could take, that there would be Confederate sympathizers in the jury pool. Secondly, the attorney for Jefferson Davis was the fellow by the name of Charles O'Connor, a New York lawyer trained not in any kind of law school, but the old-fashioned way of reading books. And he was a quintessential manipulator. He single-handedly convinced William Everts and Richard Dana, the government lawyers, that he was looking forward to the trial to vindicate secession. And every time he did so, he gave Dana and Everts the willies, because they did not want to go back and report to Andrew Johnson that they had lost this trial. For 2.5 years, Charles O'Connor kept up this charade. By the way, in the interim, Charles O'Connor was able to get Jefferson Davis released on bail. Believe it or not, a federal crime, which was subject to capital punishment, they let Davis out, and Davis immediately went to Montreal, Canada, to be with his wife. The plan, of course, was that since Davis was on trial for his life, O'Connor may very well tell him, when the trial resumes, you may not want to come back and skip bail. So that was a plan that Davis had in his back pocket. Bottom line, for 2.5 years, delay after delay, no trial of Davis. Let's turn our attention to General Lee. Now, General Lee went to see General Grant at Appomattox to get terms of surrender. Grant gave him terms of surrender that included a parole. The parole meaning that all officers and men would not be disturbed. The government would not prosecute them if they obeyed the law. Now, this, in effect, was the get out of a treason trial card for General Lee. After Appomattox, both Stanton, the Secretary of War, and the President said to General Grant, "What were you thinking?" And of course, Grant said, well, he had discussed this plan for surrender with Lincoln and had his approval. And number two, I'm the general, I control the army, and it is in my authority to make these decisions. This prompted a major dispute between Johnson, Stanton, and Grant. General Grant, to his credit, was a man of principle. And what he said to Johnson and to Stanton was, I was the general, I had the power, I did this, and if you don't stick to the agreement, I'm going to resign. That put Johnson and Stanton in a bit of a pickle. They just did not want to do it. So there was further delay. Meanwhile, General Lee applied for a pardon, and Johnson held on to it without granting it. Now, both of these cases, after several years, just languished until Christmas of 1868, when President Andrew Johnson issues his uniform amnesty for Confederate officers that stopped the prosecutions of both Davis and Lee. Now, this was a significant change on the part of Andrew Johnson. He started off being very vengeful against the former rebels, transformed into a person who wanted to hear them make individual applications for pardons to him personally. Then he was impeached in May, but not convicted, in May of 1868. His political future was pretty much over. So as a lasting kind of stick it to the radical Republicans who made my life a political hell, Andrew Johnson issues this general amnesty, which stops the prosecution of all Confederates, including Davis and Lee. So the issue of secession, which was going to be the major defense in the Lee and the Davis trials, never gets presented. The year after Johnson's amnesty, the U.S. Supreme Court decides a case with Salmon B. Chase as the author of the opinion, in a case called Texas versus White. This is a case involving the payment of Reconstruction bonds to the state of Texas. Sort of a strange context, but the issue turned on whether Texas could be an original party for invoking the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court. And it raised the issue of what happened to Texas during the period of secession. Well, very cleverly, Chief Justice Chase writes an opinion in which he says that secession was unconstitutional, but Texas never stopped being a state with the power to issue these bonds. And he wrote the following in a very short paragraph. The Constitution, in all of its provisions, looks to an indestructible union composed of indestructible states. That was his word, his last words on the issue of secession. Now, when you look at the opinion, you say, holy cow, this is pretty unpersuasive. I mean, it's nothing more than his assertions. And most of the public, upon hearing about this decision, had that conclusion that this really didn't resolve the issue one bit. So, what was the constitutional issue of secession resolved? Well, the answer would be, as a technical matter, yes. In Texas v. White, that was the holding. Also, we have the battlefield victory. What else do we want? I mean, most important social issues are decided by controversial decisions of the Supreme Court. But I suggest, you know, we're not completely satisfied because here the moral scales are totally out of balance. We believe, I think rightly, that the South may have lost the war, but it has won the battle over historic memory. This is the sheer measure of death caused by in the Civil War, more than 680,000 people. Thousands of U.S. troops were killed by Southern troops. 4 million slaves were liberated, but the promise of full civil rights has never been fulfilled. So, what more is missing here? And I suggest to you the following. There's no admission or defining statement by anyone in power in the South, Lee or Davis, or even by our government, that secession was unconstitutional, other than in Texas v. White, that secession led to the South's attempt to destroy the nation and preserve slavery, all of which are simply evil. At the same time, as this moral scale remains unbalanced, we're invited by the romanticism of the lost cause explanation of the Civil War that began shortly after Appomattox to accept that the Civil War was a legitimate endeavor by honorable people fighting for acceptable causes. Now, we all are familiar with the lost cause, Gone with the Wind. The 1939 movie is probably the best example of that. But I'd suggest there's something more at work here. Last month, during one of those C-SPAN presentations, S.C. Gwynne was treated to an in-depth review, and he spent 2 hours describing his fine work on the Civil War, and particularly his biography of Stonewall Jackson. And he's written very well about Jackson and explained his unique skill set and why, in effect, the Civil War and Stonewall Jackson, the man met his moment. But somewhere near the end of it, there was a call-in. And this caller said to Mr. Gwynne, "Why are we celebrating, and why are you celebrating the life of Stonewall Jackson, given his treasonous conduct, all the death he's responsible for, and the evil he perpetrated?" And Mr. Gwynne quite candidly said that's a whole different part of the equation in looking at the Civil War, the moral view, but that he accepted that most of the work that he was doing is devoid of that fundamental point. When we look back and we say to Lee and Davis, should there have been a treason trial? One could say, yes, the government should have had more fortitude and tried them with the belief that they would be convicted. Neither Lee nor Davis during their lifetimes showed any or took any responsibility for starting the war or the way they conducted the war. They believed their cause was just up until the time of their death. There's a recent biography of General Chamberlain that has come out. And there's one little portion that I found kind of harrowing. And that is, they describe a wounded General Chamberlain at Appomattox. Following the surrender, he gives the order shoulder arms as a sign of respect to the rebel troops who were marching out. And he said to the general, "You know, I think we finally will be near peace." And this Confederate general said to Chamberlain, "You may forgive us, but we won't be forgiven. There is rancor in our hearts, which you little dream of. We hate you, sir." Now, I thought to myself, are we asking too much for some kind of admission of guilt on the part of maybe Lee or Jackson and others? And I am reminded that in the 14th Amendment in Section 3, there is what they call a disability provision that you may know is being invoked now as an effort to keep Donald Trump off the ballot in certain states. But basically, it's a provision that says if you participated in the Civil War, and of course, now they're trying to say any type of insurrection or rebellion, you're disqualified from office. But then there's a provision for Congress to lift that disability. And there has been some work done on what efforts Congress made in individual circumstances to lift the disability, and in particular with General Longstreet, who was in effect restored to full ability to become an office holder, which he did in Louisiana. But what it demanded was a concession of guilt, of remorse for the acts taken by General Longstreet during the course of the Civil War. My point being that the amnesty and pardon system that was set up after Appomattox was prospective only. It's, I will abide by the laws. I will support efforts by the Union to reconstruct the South. There was no requirement whatsoever to say, I take responsibility or I'm accountable for what happened in the Civil War and the death and destruction caused. And I say that while the issue of secession remains in this kind of ambiguous state, we also need a necessary corrective to our study of Civil War, particularly military history, to keep that moral context in mind. Thank you.
That was a phenomenal presentation.
Fantastic. Thank you.
Excellent.
Can we get to ask questions?
Sure.
Yes, it's open to questions.
Oh, boy. Where would I start?
Just keep it short. Because I'll keep it short.
On the Constitution, it's illegal for any state to have a compact with another state or a commerce agreement. And it also very specifically says states cannot be divided to become more states. So therefore, it seems to me easy to the light, to the, you know, to the difficult, that if you can't divide your state, you certainly can't divide the whole country. Plus, the preamble says that the whole purpose of the Constitution is for blessings and sure tranquility. And the Articles of Confederation calls the Union perpetual. All we did was perfect it. So I think that the North did a beautiful feint on Mr. Calhoun and others that there never was a legal right to secession. But I'm reading the Hartford Convention. Now, maybe it'll convince me. Maybe I'll convince you. I mean, if you concede
That's a question. Come on.
All right. So that's the people. Question. I don't see the legal right there based on those reasons. No compact, only allowed to divide, can't divide a state.
Let,
you can only
let them answer.
Okay. Go ahead.
Well, I'll let Tom handle the major issue, but I just would say to you, what about the situation with West Virginia and Virginia, where during the Civil War, West Virginia separated out from Virginia, really based on the Unionists on one side and the rebels on the other?
Well, I only comment I would make is it essentially comes down to, if you're going to take the compact theory, do you have a right to withdraw? You know, do you have a right to, lawyers say, rescind the contract? You know, was there a misunderstanding at the time it was formed? And what right would that be? You know, and of course, there was a reference to nations having an ability to withdraw from agreements. We saw that, I think, when Donald Trump wouldn't stay in the Iran agreement, and you know, the United States had the right to withdraw from it. But the you know, the South was not a nation. I mean, they call themselves a nation, but they were not a nation because that assumes the fact, namely that their secession was legal. So I agree with you that the secession was not constitutional. For all sorts of reasons. And when you examine almost any basis that's cited for it on analysis, it doesn't survive review.
And the West Virginia leaving is obviously a violation.
Let somebody else, please.
Virginia was in trouble. So Virginia was at fault.
No, different context, different circumstances.
Please let somebody, Lieutenant Colonel Catta has his hand raised. Ken, you want to ask your question? Unmute yourself.
I wanted to bring something else out that Mr. Maloney had brought out about Longstreet. There were two other ex-Confederates that I know of that were also involved with this 14th Amendment thing, and that was Joe Wheeler and Fitzhugh Lee. Joe Wheeler actually served as a congressman until the Spanish-American War and volunteered to McKinley to serve to command a cavalry division in Cuba, and was and one of his subordinates was Theodore Roosevelt. And so, and Fitzhugh Lee was also commissioned a major general in the army, which meant both of them, Wheeler and Fitzhugh Lee, had to take the oath again. So this is kind of makes you wonder what application the 14th Amendment has.
Well, I can tell you that that's the issue that's now before, I know, the Colorado court and I think the Minnesota court in the context of Donald Trump. But what I was impressed by was not sort of the requirement that or the disqualification itself, but the fact that there was a provision for redemption, in effect, that probably would have had a therapeutic value for more than Longstreet, Wheeler, and Fitzhugh Lee. And that is that it wasn't simply that they were going to promise henceforward to support the United States, but, you know, the concession that what they had previously been engaged in when they violated their oaths was wrong.
Yeah, they ironically, when Wheeler went to one of the encampments for the United Confederate Veterans, he was shunned by the rest of them because they were very angry about him wearing the blue again.
Mm. Yeah, and of course, Longstreet, and is I think a biography by Elizabeth Varon of Virginia on Longstreet. He became a supporter of Reconstruction in Louisiana, and also was shunned.
Henry, I don't see any. I'm not on my board. Are there any questions? I don't have Q&A or in the. I can't see it on my board whether or not.
Ed asks a question about Ed Flanagan. That is, how about West Virginia seceding from Virginia?
To be honest, I understood that had happened. And it always seemed to me, as I indicated previously, kind of a problematic issue, particularly for the North, given their positions on secession, because it really was, in effect, Virginia dividing itself and into two states. And to me, it's an anomaly that was accepted probably because of wartime necessity, but I don't think there's any real constitutional analysis that
Virginia was in rebellion. So therefore West Virginia has to do just stay with the Union. That's a requirement. Right. Virginia is required to separate from the rebelling state.
Henry, please let Henry go through the question and answers.
That's the only one in chat right now.
Yeah. All right. I think it's, let's put it this way. We're running a little bit late. It's almost 8:30. We've been on the air since 6:30. And I want to, before we go, I want to thank Barry Crompton for his presentation. I want to thank John and Tom for their presentation, and hopefully it'll be picked up by CLE, a little more prestige for organization. Our next meeting will be in January. There won't be any in November. And that will be, we're going to do another Winter of Mead series, which is also well-received for our organization. Next month, normally we would have the book club. However, John Sullivan has prepared a series of trivia questions. We're going to try it out on a small group to see how it works. Normally, when we had our trivia question, we did it before at a large group, and it went, we were able to answer immediately, but now apparently you have to raise your hand or button or however it works. So we're going to try it on a small group. Previous questions that John had submitted are tough. They really are hard. So I think you'll have a good time. I think it'll be a lot of fun to attend. Meantime, I want everybody to have a happy Thanksgiving, Merry Christmas, Happy New Year, and I think we could say goodnight. Thank you.
Very courageous presentation, John.
Yes, thank you. Very excellent. Great research.
It was a pleasure.
Well done, Jay. Absolutely.
Yes.
Thank you, Judge. Well,
very enjoyable.
Well presented.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I enjoyed it very, very much.
That's Professor Summer Edmund from Texas, who's
Texas.
On.
Texas. From Texas.
Texas.
Thank you. Good night.
Good night.
Thanks, everybody.
Good night.
Thank you.
Thank you.